Welcome everyone to our webinar on the Sustainable Finance Disclosure Regulation Practical Considerations. My name is Mikhaelle Schiappacasse, and I'm a partner at Dechert's Financial Services Group in London. I'm joined by three of my financial services colleagues and members of Dechert's Global ESG Working Group: Angelo, Lercara, a partner in our Munich office; Ciara O'Leary, a partner in our Dublin office; and Simon Wright, counsel, also in our London office. We are particularly pleased to be joined by Tatjana Greil, Castro, co-head of public markets and a director at Muzinich & Co. We are going to begin today's webinar by providing a summary overview of the requirements of the Sustainable Finance Disclosure Regulation, or SFDR, or the Disclosure Regulation, and then we will move into a panel discussion focusing on some of the practical implications of the regulations. As part of this, we would like to try and to address questions from the audience, so please do make use of the Q&A function. With that, I would like to hand it off to Simon to begin.
Hi, Mikhaelle. Good afternoon, everyone. So, yeah, just to start, an overview of the EU ESG regulatory framework, its core requirements. And, this is a set of regulations that do overlap, which is why we chose to use a Venn diagram to sort of make the point at a high level. So, firstly, the SFDR, or Sustainable Finance Disclosure Regulation. I mean, as many people are aware, this is a regulation that comes into force on the 10th of March of next year, and it imposes new transparency and disclosure requirements in relation to ESG to so-called financial market participants dealing in financial products. A financial market participant is an AIFM, a UCITS ManCo, a portfolio manager, a pension provider, or a credit institution which itself provides portfolio management, and a financial product as defined under SFDR is an AIF, a UCITS, a pension product, or a segregated account, a segregated mandate. In terms of the disclosure requirements, they are both website-based. There are mandatory website disclosures in relation to ESG. They're pre-contractual as well, so things will need to go into PPMs and marketing materials. And they're also periodic, so there's periodic reporting to investors. So that's the first limb of the EU ESG regulatory framework. It's important to note, though, that SFDR, it does not apply to UK-regulated entities, only providing services to non-EU persons at a very high level. SFDR was not onshored as part of the Brexit process, so this EU regulation will not be retained in English law. However, as a matter of practice, if you are a UK firm dealing with the EU counterparties or providing a service into the EU, our view is, and we think this is market practice as well, that you will still need to comply with SFDR. Second limb here, second circle, the RTS to SFDR. I think the key message here is, you know, these put the meat on the bones of the various articles in SFDR, the disclosures, but the RTS have been delayed. They were meant to come into place in March next year. That's now been kicked down the can, by the European Commission. We're expecting the RTS to come into force in 2022. However, and importantly, this does not mean, though, that the relevant articles of SFDR that rely on the RTS, I'm thinking here particularly Article 8 and Article 9, no longer apply. They are still coming into force, albeit that firms that are in scope need to use their best efforts to comply with these obligations on a principles basis. So, you know, there's still a certain amount of uncertainty as to what this means. You know, it's not the case the RTS apply, but something still does apply. What that something is still something that needs to be thought through and worked out. But again, the message here is that even if the RTS are not there, the relevant article in the level one of the SFDR still comes into force in March next year. The last circle here, taxonomy. The taxonomy regulation, this is the criteria for establishing whether or not an economic activity is in fact environmentally sustainable. And it's important here, because the taxonomy regulation itself knocks on to and applies to the SFDR, though from 2022. For an activity to be environmentally sustainable, it has to meet the following four criteria. It's got to contribute substantially to one or more environmental objectives. It mustn't significantly harm an environmental objective. It's got to be carried out in compliance with minimum safeguards, and it must comply with technical screening criteria. As I mentioned earlier, this matters because the taxonomy regulation will amend SFDR to take into account that for an activity to be ESG, to be environmentally sustainable, it must, following the introduction of the taxonomy regulation, it must do no significant harm. So that's a very sort of quick overview of the core requirements of the ESG regulatory framework. And I'd now like to pass on to Ciara just to go through some of the more detailed disclosures needed by firms, by financial market participants at a firm level, and also the types of mandated disclosure that will be needed at a product level.
Thanks, Simon. As Simon mentioned, under the disclosure regulations, they apply to firm national market participants, which really you could kind of group that together as the management section, and then also to financial products, so the product section, AIFs, UCITS, segregated mandates, pension products. And as they apply at those two different levels, they also require disclosure at those two levels. So the disclosure requirements for firms, kind of what we would probably commonly speak to as the management entities, and then at the product levels. And there's three types of mandated disclosures. So there's website disclosure, which really will be mainly for the firms, pre-contractual disclosure, which will really be for the products. That's talking about amendments to offering documentation. And then there are also periodic reporting requirements in respect to the various obligations under the disclosure regulations. So I suppose that the next million-dollar question is, what is the disclosure concept? So at the firm or management entity level, there's website disclosure, regardless of whether your product is ESG or not, and we're going to come on to speak to what type of classification products we'll have and the kind of nitty-gritty around that a little bit later in the webinar. But regardless of how you classify your products, management entities are required to have policies on the integration of sustainability risks into their investment activities. So how they go about integrating sustainability into their day-to-day asset management business. There's also a requirement for due diligence policies on the adverse impact of sustainability risks on investment decisions. I think this one has probably been the most controversial, or certainly the one that's receiving a lot of consideration and review and discussion within the industry, because effectively what it's asking you to do is provide information or your policy on what is a negative consequence for either the E, S, or G as a result of your investment decision. Now, because of that, there is a de minimis rule. So it is comply or explain unless you have 500 employees, and in which case then it is mandatory to comply with the adverse impact statement. And the final website disclosure that's required at the management level is in relation to remuneration policies. What they're getting at here is remuneration policies should be updated to include sustainability risks into how remuneration is calculated for the management entities. At the product level, there's pre-contractual disclosure required and integration of sustainability risk in the management of the product. And what this really means is in the offering document of the various financial product, you need to provide information as to how the product integrates sustainability into its investment decision-making processes. And this applies regardless of whether you have an ESG product or not. You're also required to have a pre-contractual and periodic disclosure in respect of the adverse impact statement I mentioned earlier. But again, there is that de minimis requirement, comply or explain, unless 500 employees, in which case it's mandatory. And then one point I would probably just note around the pre-contractual disclosure for the adverse impact is we are beginning to see a bit of a trend for management entities and for product entities that may well fall below the 500 employee category, but because of the positioning or the significance that they're giving to ESG within their own organization, we are seeing people choosing to comply with the adverse impact statement for those kind of more holistic reasons. And we're going to come to speak about that a little bit later in the webinar as well. And I think finally, in terms of the product disclosures, there are additional pre-contractual website and periodic disclosures. So again, updates the offering documentation to your websites, and depending on whether you're complying with adverse impact to your periodic reporting in respect of two new products that have been introduced by the disclosure regulations, or perhaps I should say two new product classifications, light green products and dark green products. We're going to speak about what light green and dark green products mean a little bit later in the webinar. So we will discuss that in a little while. I suppose now the next thing is I was going to hand over to Angelo, maybe for him to give us a bit of a summary on how the disclosure regulations impact non-EU financial market participants. So Angelo, over to you.
Yes, many thanks, Ciara. And actually, it's an interesting question and probably a very relevant and important one for those asset managers who are not in the EU. We've just heard it, the SFDR will be applicable to EU FMPs, but what about non-EU FMPs? So what about US managers? What about Swiss managers? What about, in a few weeks, UK managers? How does it apply to them? And I guess there are two buckets, let's say, into which you could look and which will be relevant. So the first one is pretty clear. And by the way, the disclosure regulation does not contain any indication on jurisdictional limitation or scope. And there were various occasions where the Commission made clear that in a nutshell, whoever markets funds or other services or financial instruments in Europe should be caught by the rules. So at least it's clear that you need some nexus with the EU. So it is expected to apply directly to anyone who would, any non-EU FMPs who markets its fund in Europe under the so-called national private placement regime. So whenever you register your, let's assume, non-EU fund, and you are the non-EU AIFM in this case, whenever you register the fund in any of the European countries, you would need to comply with the rules, you would need to comply with the disclosure requirements, and you would need to put information into your marketing documents, so the PPM. And then I guess it's fair to say that if a non-EU FMP is managing segregated mandate for a client based in Europe or any EEA member state, and depending on the country, actually, if the country would assume that you would be deemed to be providing the service on the ground locally in the European country, then the asset manager would be caught as well by the rules, and they would be applicable to the mandate and to the whole contractual relationship. The second important aspect is that if the non-EU FMP would not be caught because it has not registered the fund in Europe, or it is not managing a mandate in a country which would assume that the service would be provided locally, there are many ways that would have an impact on the way many non-EU FMPs are actually doing business with European investors. And many of those asset managers would be acting, for instance, as delegate portfolio manager for EEA clients, and they would be managing European funds or European segregated accounts for those investors, and they would be acting as a delegate for a European AIFM. And in those situations, we would expect that the delegation agreement or the IMA, which would be entered into between the AIFM and the delegate portfolio manager, which is domiciled outside of the EU, that these agreements would contain obligations and requirements of the non-EU FMP, which would actually mirror the AIFM's the European AIFM's requirement to comply with the rules. So in other words, the non-EU FMPs would be bound by the same rules as the AIFM in terms of disclosure and in terms of ESG criteria. And that would be another way how the rules, although they would not be applicable directly, would however be applicable by way of contractual agreements. Okay.
Thank you, Angelo. So just a couple points to pick up on that were covered by my colleagues. So obviously there are different types of financial market participants. We've mentioned AIFMs, we've mentioned UCITS management companies, firms that undertake portfolio management, collective portfolio management as well. It also, the regulation also captures investment advisors, so non-discretionary advisors. The rules that apply to them are a little bit different, but they're sort of comparable to what we're discussing here. So non-discretionary advisors are also in scope. As Angelo was saying, when you're talking about a firm that really doesn't have any European nexus, you know, you're not marketing there, you haven't been subject to reverse solicitation by a firm that might want to push down the obligations contractually, then you may find yourself out of scope. So, for example, if you have a European institutional, you know, professional client who has approached you by way of reverse solicitation, and where they themselves do not then come to you and say, we actually require you to comply with these obligations because we have our own compliance obligations, then you might find that you're out of scope despite having some access to European money. But as a general matter, most managers who have a European nexus will come to scope. So I want to now move on from this overview to something a little bit more granular, a little bit more specific in terms of looking at the key requirements. But maybe before we get too much into the weeds, I'd like to bring Tatjana into the conversation and ask, you know, from a practical implementation perspective, what is Muzinich finding to be most challenging in terms of, you know, integrating SFDR into the firm's business practice?
Yeah, I mean, for us, it is, you know, something that we are still grappling with. I mean, I tell you, you know, calls like this are still very valuable to us in order to understand exactly what it is that the requirements are. And then practically, it is to get hold of those disclosures, because it's all well and good if the regulator is telling the asset manager to disclose on, you know, substantial risks. But clearly, we then need to turn, and this is clearly the regulator's intention, we then need to turn to the companies and say, look, we need to comply with those rules for us to be able to invest in your company. We need to have that disclosure from you. And that is something that, you know, where it very much depends on which asset class you're investing in. So, for instance, if you invest in European investment grade, then that would be something that, you know, companies would comply with most likely, or to a large extent. There is lots of information provided by those companies already, or, you know, large publicly listed European equity companies. When you come to smaller companies that are in levered finance, that are privately owned, it is still a long way for us to be able to actually have that information. And, you know, we're still engaging with banks, the underwriters, the law firms, the companies themselves, to make them see how important that information is becoming for us. And at some point, it will just be a matter of, because they always say, look, you know, will you get funding cheaper if you have good ESG policy in place? I think very quickly it will become either a company is investable because they provide the information, or is not investable.
Thank you. So if we now start looking at the specific requirements, I'm going to start with the Article 3 requirement and sort of take it at the same time as the Article 6 requirement, because they are related. The one, Article 3, relates to the firm level requirement to disclose how it integrates sustainability risks into its investment management activities. And Article 6 basically asks the same question, but looks at it at the level of the relevant product. So Angelo, perhaps one of the questions that tends to come up around Article 3 is whether we really need to have a single approach to integrating sustainability rich in, risks into a firm's investment management activities, or whether there are other ways you can look at it, for instance, by strategy. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yes, I do. So I think you're right. It heavily depends on the investment strategy. And I think Tatjana has just mentioned it and has made it very clear. So the Article 3 disclosure requirement, or the provision Article 3, is all about you have, if you are an asset manager, you have to disclose how you deal with sustainability risks and how you consider those risks, let's say, in addition to all of the other risks that you are considering anyway, you know, credit risk, counterparty risk, liquidity risk, and the like. And then there are, I guess, different ways to look at sustainability risk. You could say, well, that's a standalone additional risk, or you could say, well, look, it's actually intrinsic. If it is in your credit risk, if it is intrinsic in your counterparty risk, it's not a standalone risk. So I think it will be interesting to see how the industry is going to apply this one. And then the sustainability risk actually depends on the strategy. So if you are a real estate manager, you have a different risks relating to environmental or social governance aspects than a bond manager or an equity manager. For real estate manager, for instance, extreme weather events may play a major role if invest in real estate and in a geographical area where you would expect lots of flooding and extreme weather events, you have to consider this risk into your investment decision. And so you have to come up with a policy, and you have to publish or disclose this policy or summary of it on your website. So that's Article 3.
Right. Thank you. So I think that where we get to there is that, to a certain degree, as you're saying, there's a general question of, you know, how have you integrated it into your risk management activities as a general matter? And if you're a smaller firm, you might do that in one way. But if you're a larger firm with multiple teams running multiple strategies, potentially in multiple different jurisdictions, it may be that when you look at how you present your approach for website disclosure purposes, you might want to be looking at it, for example, at a strategy level, because that will be a more effective way to communicate your approach to the end investor.
Right.
Now, this particular requirement, Article 3, comes into play on the 10th of March 2021. So does the related requirement of doing your Article 6 pre-contractual disclosures in your prospectus. So every product that's out there, any fund product, needs to be updated by the 10th of March 2021 to disclose, you know, how you integrate your sustainability risks into your process for that particular product. And you're going to also need to communicate the same thing on any kind of SEG mandate, you know, in your investment management agreement, or however you've contractually set up that particular relationship. And the one area where there is the potential that you might not need to do such an update is if you're dealing with a closed-ended fund product and that product is no longer being marketed, because in that case, there's an argument that that document is no longer a pre-contractual document providing pre-contractual disclosure because you are not marketing it. You are past the contractual phase of that particular document. And that's still a matter of industry interpretation. There's been no specific guidance on that, but I think quite a few firms are starting to take that particular approach. And Angelo, on the Article 6 disclosure process, I think, you know, one of the things you started talking about in Article 3 was, you know, the sort of parts that go into play when you're talking about how to disclose the integration of sustainability risks. But under Article 6, there's sort of a dual process that needs to be provided for. And perhaps you can talk about that a bit.
Yeah, actually, you need to add, so you need to disclose into your pre-contractual material, so PPM, you need to disclose how you consider sustainability risks, but then you need to add an aspect. You need to consider what the likely impact is of the risk to your return, so that so you need to make an assessment. What are the sustainability risks for my strategy, for my product, and what is the likely impact of those sustainability risks on the return of my product, in order for the investor into your fund, if you're a fund manager, to be clear about the risks and about the potential impact, negative impact on the returns. If you, as a result of your assessment, say, well, look, we have considered the sustainability risks and we do not believe that they are relevant or that there is any negative impact on our investments. So in such a case, it's possible to do that. Of course, that's a possible result. And in such a case, you have to explain why, and obviously you should do it in as detailed as appropriate way, in order to, you know, to disclose what is relevant to the investor. And actually, the what is maybe also important, the Article 3 and 6 requirements, they are completely unrelated to, you know, any potential ESG preference of the client or any ESG strategy. It's more just to, you know, consider these additional risks or these intrinsic risks, and to disclose how you deal with it with them should you know anything go wrong in terms of ESG.
Thank you. Where we get to, I think, with this is that you have your website disclosure, which is a summary of your policy on the integration of sustainability risk. Then you have the prospectus level disclosure, for example, if you're dealing with a fund, and you'll disclose, you know, how you integrate this into your investment process. That would probably be somewhere in the document where you would disclose your investment process, generally speaking, you know, and its length would depend on how much you have to say about it, bearing in mind that you don't want to be talking too much about ESG-related criteria if you are not, in fact, an ESG product in the SFDR sense, which is a light green and a dark green fund, which we'll talk about in a little bit more. And also, then you have to look at your risk factors. Are your risk factors showing the sustainability risks that are relevant for your particular strategy? So two different levels. I think one question that comes up quite commonly is, you know, I'm a fund-to-fund manager, or this is a fund-to-fund strategy, and what do I actually disclose? There are a couple different ways you can look at it. I think the point is that when you're disclosing how you integrate sustainability risks into your process, it's how the fund-to-fund manager does it, not the underlying fund, because it would be very difficult to do that on the look-through basis. So the question would be really, what are your due diligence processes in terms of talking to the underlying managers about their integration of sustainability risks? But you're probably really going to need to look at it at your level, because unless you have all your managers lined up from day one, it's unlikely that you're going to be able to disclose how they deal with the integration of sustainability risks. Now, you might want to consider whether in the long term you actually want to disclose that to your end investors, because, for instance, you've been requested to provide that and further detail. But I think you probably need to be looking at your firm level rather than the underlying funds. I think that we will move on from Article 3 and Article 6. So, you know, the sort of the most basic disclosure requirements under SFDR to Article 4. And I think, you know, we've already touched on this briefly. It's a real question for a lot of clients. You know, do I need to provide an adverse impact statement? If I don't need to, if I'm not mandated to do so, should I anyway? And this is because quite a few asset management firms in particular are going to fall below the 500 employee mark. So if we remind ourselves the actual threshold in order to have to provide an adverse impact statement is an average of 500 employees on the firm's balance sheet during the financial year, or where the financial market participant at issue is itself the parent of a large group, so that's a large group within the meaning of the accounting directive, that with on a consolidated basis meets that 500 employee threshold. So only at that point is it mandated to disclose. So we actually went out and took a survey on this particular issue from a number of firms to find out whether or not they were intending to comply or explain. And out of 50 respondents, 36% said that they would be complying, 26% said they would be explaining, and 38% said they didn't know yet. And I think quite a few people in the industry remain in the undecided category. Those firms that decided to comply on a voluntary basis, it covered the entire spectrum in terms of size of firms. So it included firms with under $1 billion in AUM, up through obviously firms in excess of $250 billion. Although the larger firms were unsurprisingly the ones who were complying because they had over 500 employees. Interestingly, approximately half of the respondents who said they were not intending to comply indicated that they would comply if a substantial number of their peers did. So this is an area of some sensitivity, obviously. Quite a lot of thought needs to go into whether complying is, you know, operationally feasible at this standpoint, what compliance looks like, because as has been mentioned by Simon, you know, we don't have the regulatory technical standards that give the guidance. And I think maybe one of the things that we should look at here, and Angelo, maybe I can address this question to you, is, you know, we don't have the RTS. It's not final. It's not in agreed form. Should we be relying on that? Should we be using that in making our decisions of how to comply, for example, with Article 4 disclosure?
Well, it's an interesting point, and it's a tricky question, actually, because on the one hand, it's there, it contains valuable information on how to deal with the extremely technical approach of the Level 1 regulation, and it shows how the regulators look at it, and it also, you know, encourages maybe the industry and the advisors, because it shows sometimes the desperation of the regulators that had this task to implement an RTS or a level two, and were really struggling with the way to do it properly, because the level one regulation is actually written in a pretty technical way, and the commission, you know, requiring the regulators to do additional work. So on the one hand, it's extremely valuable. It, you know, it's maybe it may be inspiring to how to disclose information. On the other hand, it's not there yet. It's just the draft. It's not applicable. And I think it would be wrong to implement it as it is, as it was already enacted. I think it's wrong because it would take away flexibility to the industry. It would take away, you know, arguments for a further consultation. And I think what should be done is to implement level one and the requirements as meticulously as possible, you know, to disclose the information as required in level one, but to do it in an own way, to, you know, to, as good as possible, but in an own, based on an own interpretation. And so it should not be, it should not be applied, because it's not there yet, and as I said, it would take away flexibility. That's my point of view.
Thank you, Angelo. Yeah, I think it's an important one to think about, is whether we want to treat rules that are still sort of technically under consultation as somehow final and binding. Angelo, maybe just very briefly, if you could address Article 5 and the obligations around the remuneration policy.
Yeah, so Article 5, very quickly, Article 5 of the disclosure regulation requires the FMPs to disclose the way in which they mirror the sustainability risks consideration into their remuneration policies. As you may know, all European, the EU FMPs are subject to other set of rules which already require them to set up remuneration policies, which in essence would prevent excessive risk taking. And the task here is actually to implement into those existing policies sustainability and ESG related aspects, and to create a link to those excessive risk taking by including also ESG related risks. And maybe it's also one of the purposes to actually, you know, create some sort of maybe bonus system with which you would create, a bonus system in which the employees would be rewarded by maybe achieving certain ESG targets if the firm on a firm level would like to implement those. So that's Article 5. You need to amend your existing policy and you need to publish it on the website. And again, it will be interesting how this will be applying to non-EU FMPs, like delegate asset managers from non-EU countries, highly likely again through the delegation agreement and IMAs. That's Article 5.
Thank you, Angelo. So now I would like to move on to light green funds and dark green funds and non-green funds, because this is an area where we're having quite a few conversations with our clients, and we assume that similar conversations are going on in the industry. You know, how do you distinguish between them? So perhaps, Ciara, we could start by discussing sort of the difference or how you would identify a light green product and how you might identify a dark green product.
Sure, thanks. So these two new badges are kind of two new concepts that have come under the disclosure regulations. So maybe taking light green first. A light green fund is a fund that, amongst other investment objectives, has the promotion of sustainable finance. So it does not mean that the entire portfolio and the entire objective has to be the promotion of sustainable finance, but amongst it, it needs to have some form of promotion aspect where it is promoting either the E, S, or G. A dark green product is a product that's only investment objective is the promotion of sustainable finance, so promotion of E, S, or G in its sole objective. And then I suppose the question becomes, well, what is a sustainable investment? And I think this is where you have the interaction between the taxonomy and all the various different pieces of regulation that are out there. But really what a sustainable investment, or what the disclosure regulations mean by a sustainable investment, and you'll have to forgive me, this is a little bit of a long-winded sentence, but I'm just going to get through and then we can kind of pick out the pieces that are important afterwards. It means an investment that is an economic activity that contributes to an environmental objective that can be independently measured by a key resource or efficiency indicator. So something about the use of energy, renewable energy, raw materials, water, land, where you can verify the impact on it. It means an economic activity that contributes to a social objective. So in particular, an investment that contributes to the tackling of an inequality, fostering social cohesion, social integration, or labor relations, or it does something to help socially disadvantaged communities. And this is the kind of key part, provided that such investments do not significantly harm any of those objectives. We're going to come back to that in a little bit. And the final point is that the investee company should follow good corporate governance. And I think that's the point, really. We all get out of ESG, we all have a relatively good understanding of what the E is, but the S and the G are a little bit more nebulous. So in order to be a dark green fund, you have to have a sole objective to investing in one of those things, and you also can cause no significant harm. When you're looking at a dark green product in the context of the E, this is where you need to look at the taxonomy regulations, and effectively it means you need to be investing in something that's promoting the six characteristics that are listed in Article 9 of the taxonomy, which is climate change mitigation, climate change adaption, sustainable use of protection of water and marine resources, the transition to the circular economy, pollution prevention and control, and the protection and restoration of biodiversity and ecosystems. So you can probably imagine it's actually particularly difficult to actually be a dark green product. Not only have you a sole investment objective, but then you also have to look at the interplay of significant harm. And what we're looking at in that is, just because one part of the investment is good, if it has a negative consequence or causes a significant harm, then it can't be deemed to be a proper sustainable investment. So perhaps an example of that would be, let's say you think you're investing in something that's going to create hydroelectric power, so reduce the dependence upon fossil fuels, but it turns out that they're building that dam in a section of the Amazon, and they're going to, you know, knock down several acres of trees and cause deforestation and endanger the biodiversity of that area. That in itself is not a sustainable investment, because it is not sustainable all round. It's going to cause a significant harm to one other aspect of your environmental objectives. So the reality is it's extremely difficult to be a dark green fund. And I think most of the products that we're going to see are actually going to be light green funds. When you're looking at light green, that really is getting to, amongst other objectives, the promotion of sustainable investments in the environmental space, the social space, or the governance space. And this doesn't mean that you can only invest in sustainable investments to be a light green fund. In fact, you can invest outside of sustainable investments, that definition I read out earlier, and still be a light green fund. You can have a certain amount of mix in your portfolio where your overall portfolio isn't fully ES or G. But again, you would need to be, you know, somewhat mindful of the mix within that, that you aren't having other things in there that are so significantly damaging that that might tip you outside of being slightly incongruous for calling yourself a light green fund. You know, I think the answer is we've seen relatively few products that have been categorized as dark green fund, and much of the debate is around whether you're a light green fund or not, which I know we're going to speak to a little bit further in a minute as well. I think it's important to remember, if you are categorizing yourself as a light green fund, you do need to get quite granular in terms of your disclosure. So you're looking at your portfolio composition, kind of percentages around that of what is in the E, what is in the S, what is in the G, you know, and detailed information on how you've kind of achieved the fact that you are a light green fund.
Thanks, Ciara. So obviously what we have here are two sets of products. One where, as Ciara said, if you're a dark green fund, you know, you're really going to have to be probably something in the impact realm, because you're going to have to be very focused. And on top of that, you're going to have to make sure that you're not harming other sustainability objectives. And in the light green fund, there's more flexibility. And in fact, it doesn't appear to be the case that you need to have a single sustainable investment mm-hmm. in a light green fund, but you need to still be promoting certain light green characteristics. I think I might ask Tatjana to see whether she would be comfortable sharing with us any sort of useful approaches that Muzinich has found to looking at you know, light green fund, whether something's a light green fund, whether it's a dark green fund, you know, sort of making that kind of a decision. I don't know whether you've come up with anything that you've found has worked for you, or any aspect that you find helpful.
Yeah, in terms of dark green, right? I mean, as you say, I mean, that can be quite challenging, actually, to show that this is a pure impact fund. And just to remind everybody, you know, my focus is on credit rather than equity. So I know, for instance, with our equity colleagues, they do you can create, for instance, very specific strategies. So, for instance, you could have a theme on education, you know, promoting sort of better education and promoting equality by that. Or you could have a certain fund that is focusing on healthcare. That is not really possible when you invest in credit. So there is just sort of the universe looks very different. There are more established companies, and you wouldn't have sort of that breadth to be able to, you know, focus on one specific sector only. So what we have been thinking about, and this actually gets back to what Angelo was saying earlier, in terms of, you know, will that have a significant economic impact on a credit? Well, the decision is partly based on how the regulator will see it. So, for instance, as a very sort of obvious example, if the regulator decides that carbon emission is being taxed one way or another, then clearly carbon emission by a company will have a big economic impact. As long as everybody else pays for this externality, it will not. Of course, there are now other social considerations to consider. You know, do you still have the social license if you don't have a program to reduce carbon emission? But a lot will come down to regulation and how the regulator is enforcing, for instance, the Paris Agreement, and that companies have to comply with that. When it comes to, you know, sort of light green, so for instance, one way would be, and I think, really, it is for investors now, to the extent that regulation is already in place and clear governmental targets have already been identified, that we say we are trying to implement those targets rather than trying to do our own thing. And here, for instance, it would be if the European Union decides that they want to implement the Paris Agreement, then we can ask every company that we are investing in that they say by 2022, you should have a policy in place on how to reduce your carbon emission, and then have a clear scientifically based, you know, Paris Agreement based process in place that shows us that you will have reduced your carbon by 55%, you know, from 1990 levels by 2030. So those sort of things, you know, can be implemented. And again, you know, the driving force there is that there are clear rules have been established to do so. And then clearly, you know, there's others like circular economy and things like this that can be implemented more broadly. And this is how you can then show if you are a green product or if you're not.
Thank you. Thank you, Tatjana. I think I want to move to the other hard piece of this, which is, you know, I have a fund, I have a strategy that that, you know, does consider ESG criteria in making investment decisions. You know, does that mean that my fund is actually a light green fund? How do you sort of look to draw the distinction between something that is, you know, has ESG built into it, but maybe isn't quite raising to the level of a light green fund and a light green fund? What are certain sort of borders that can be found there or ways to think about it? Ciara, could you take us through that a bit?
Sure. So you're referencing a type of third product that we're kind of beginning to see out there that people are calling a pale green fund. I think it's fair to say that there is still a bit of a bar to get to be a light green fund, and you have to look at it in a couple of different ways. I think you have to look at the word that's being used, and it is promote. So there does need to be some form of kind of positive activity in order to tip yourself over into being a light green fund. I think there's probably a general view that negative screening alone is unlikely to make you a light green fund unless your negative screening is so negative that it almost becomes a positive. But that would have to be an extremely, extremely tight negative screening approach. I think for the most part, what we're seeing is, you know, people looking at their ESG policies and kind of seeing the net effect of those. And particularly where you have asset managers that are quite focused on this and have built out teams in this, and they do get into the weeds, kind of back to Tatjana's point earlier about, you know, needing the information to be able to make those determinations about what your project, your product is going to be. So people really reviewing their ESG policies, looking at what it is excluding, and not only what it is excluding, but what is also moving its investments to. Easier, again, you know, as referenced earlier, slightly in the equity space, but obviously, you know, Muzinich have a large practice in this in the debt space as well. So looking at the policy that you have in place, seeing what you take out of your portfolio, and more importantly, what you kind of put into your portfolio. Do you give more weighting to firms, just speaking in the environmental space, because it's slightly easier, you know, that are clearly promoting the reduction of carbon emissions, you know, helping with kind of biodiversity, water, and then reducing your exposures to probably types of industries that would be seen as having negative consequences towards water, biodiversity, carbon emissions, you know, reducing out things like cluster munitions, and kind of have a very tight look at screening in respect to the governance of the entities that you're applying your cash into. And I think that the reality is a lot of people, when they started looking at their ESG policies that they had in place, probably wasn't bringing them up to the level of that promotion, where you were kind of having a positive effect or taking a positive action, and you were seeing people more in this kind of pale green space, where, you know, they had quite a significant ESG component to what they were doing, but maybe just not enough to move it to the promotion state that's required under the regulations. I think it's going to be about disclosure as well. In some ways, it's not great, the level two being delayed, because it makes it harder for people to get the information about the types of products that they're investing in to see if they really are going to promote a positive change. And then really kind of trying to describe your own investment proceeds around how you apply ESG and your overlay. I mean, nobody wants to give away their secret sauce. But at the same time, we feel that the focus the regulators are going to have will be around greenwashing. So I think it's important for people, when they're doing their scoping exercises and determining what type of product they have, that they do kick the tires quite substantially and see that it isn't just, oh, we take out, you know, the bottom 5% of the market, but maybe rather you want to be taking something out and then giving it, you know, a higher weighting to another form of investment in order to bring yourself into that light green space. But I do think, just as you mentioned earlier, Mikhaelle, it is important to bear in mind that, you know, light green is a considerably lower bar than dark green, and it doesn't necessarily only have to be comprised of sustainable investments. So there is more scope for asset managers here, when they're planning their ESG policies, to create a product that is light green and, you know, is going to meet that promotion without kind of limiting themselves too much in the overall diversification that they want to achieve within the portfolio.
Thanks, Ciara. I think that's also something to bear in mind in terms of things around governance. So there are obviously some, you know, very good investments out there that are, you know, playing in the sustainable investment space, but basically have rubbish governance in place. And so because of this, there's definitely an argument that it wouldn't qualify as a investment that's promoting the characteristic that you're trying to promote in a light green fund. But that doesn't mean that can't be an investment in that fund. It just wouldn't be one of those investments that you would necessarily use in your periodic reporting, you know, on an annual basis, where you say, here's an investment that's promoting this particular characteristic, because it's been limited by virtue of the way the regulation is drafted. And the same thing comes into play if one of the things you do is you go in and try to encourage, shall we say, more sustainable behavior by companies. You know, once again, that might not qualify as a green investment within the light green category of Article 8, but it doesn't mean it can't be part of a light green fund which otherwise has investments that meet the specific requirements of Article 8. I think that's really important to bear in mind. Just as Ciara said, you know, obviously there are lots of different green products in the market, and they might be out there with prospectuses that say things, you know, have ESG all over them. And one of the things that needs to be considered is, you know, do I need to update this prospectus because it's not meeting a light green fund requirement, so I actually need to tone down the ESG content, make sure it just relates to the disclosure of the integration of sustainability risks to avoid the risk of it being seen to be greenwashing, as Ciara mentioned. So there's, you know, it's not just about creating green products, about looking at the products that you have and determining where it falls and what adjustments you might need to make from a disclosure perspective or indeed a strategy perspective, because you might go, it's not quite qualifying. I really want it to. So I'm going to make some adjustments to how we do our overlay or how we consider ESG criteria in making investments in this particular fund and indeed how we talk about it. And that might help you move into an Article 8 category. I'd like to ask a question very quickly of Simon, because we've been talking a lot about the distinction between light green funds in terms of sort of SFDR, but this also comes into play under the target market definition in MiFID. And just people should be aware of this when you're looking at updating your fund documents, that there's also a MiFID angle to this. So Simon, if you could address that briefly, that would be great.
Yeah, sure. So effectively now, as a consequence of the new regulation, the target market assessment you have to do as a MiFID entity is amended to assess an investor's sustainability preference. So effectively, you know, do they want to go into an Article 8 product, an Article 9 product, or not at all? But the point here is the actual directive, it effectively creates a new type of Article 8 fund or assessment process here, given that the product that falls within the amended product governance directive here is one that has the environmental and social characteristics referred to in Article 8 of SFDR. And either there's one of two things. It either pursues a sustainable investment or considers principal adverse impacts. So I think what we're seeing here is an unintended consequence that effectively, if when you're carrying out your target market assessment, if you wish to if a client or investor expresses a preference for an environmental product, you can't just put them into a straight Article 8 fund or product. It's this sort of Article 8 plus one, if you will, distinction here. And I think that the query we've got out there is, does this mean that, you know, a normal Article 8 fund that doesn't have the additional overlay in the product governance, amended product governance directive, could not be deemed to be within the investor preferences, within a target market assessment for a particular investor? I mean, the jury is still out there. The directive is not yet enforced, but it's important to realize there is this further distinction when considering target market, to look beyond a normal, if you will, Article 8 fund or product, but also look at these two other criteria as well.
Thank you, Simon. So unfortunately, we're coming to the end of our hour, and we really could have spent, you know, another couple hours talking about the various details and indeed some of the questions that came up, which we weren't able to pick up as we worked through our conversation. But I'd like to give Tatjana the last word, if she would like, and to say how significant of an impact you think SFDR will have on the day-to-day management activities of an asset manager going forward, you know, sort of regardless of whether that manager really pursues an ESG, you know, green strategy or not. Do you have any final thoughts on that?
I think it's another cog, you know, in the system, and it just indicates the change that we are in, the transition that we are in. It is clearly a burden some now to get started on it. It's a bit frustrating because we don't have the data and the information available that we are meant to be producing. But I think it's just a matter of sort of, you know, putting that ahead of us in order for us to be able to comply and to put all the wheels in motion. So in that regard, you know, given that we sort of were sitting on our hands for many years, even so we knew that we need to make changes in terms of, you know, turning into a more sustainable economy, this linear way of, you know, of the economy, the way we have been doing things so far is not working because we don't have the resources to continue it. So in that regard, I think it's coming from the right place and it's extremely important. You know, the way to get there will be a bit frustrating, but it's worth the investment.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, quite a sea of change coming coming the way of the industry over the next couple of years, because this is indeed only the beginning of the conversation, and there are a number of other initiatives underway. So I think everybody's going to have to continue to watch this space quite closely. I'm afraid that is all the time we have today, and I want to thank everybody for joining us, and in particular to Tatjana for taking the time to speak with us. Have a good day.
Thanks for having me. It has been very interesting.
Thank you so much for joining us.